We have individuals representing a lot of our important sister organizations, folks here representing MALDEF, National Council of La Raza, the College Board, California Community Colleges, Chancellor's Office, Hispanic Scholarship Fund, Hispanic College Fund. We have the Los Angeles Chamber. We have staff representatives from Congressman Baca. We have so many others. I know Pique is here and others, and we can, you know, rather than highlighting everyone, I just want to mention a few of those names. We have National Education Association represented, Alliance for Better Community. I also wanted to thank some of CHCI's partners. As I said, we're here in Los Angeles for 2 days. For today's sessions, tomorrow we have workshops we do with high school students. It will be here at Cal State Dominguez Hills, our Ready to Lead program. This is the fifth year we do it in Los Angeles, the second year we do it here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills. And one of our we have many partners that work with us on that. Walter Rodriguez, he's manager of diversity and corporate outreach of Hyundai. We have Eddie Martinez with State Farm, and of course the sponsor for our continuing the conversation reception following is the panel. I'd like to thank Raul de Quesada and Fox Deportes for your support and joining us today. Really very impressive first session. Want to just get right to the next session that will be moderated by our key partner organization and good friend, the executive director of NALEO, Arturo Vargas. Gracias.
Thank you, Esther. So, buenas tardes, everybody. And once again, thank you to CHCI, Cal State Dominguez Hills, for the opportunity to be here. My name is Arturo Vargas, executive director of the National Association of Latino Elected and Appointed Officials. So why does a political organization care about education? Now, we're an organization that's devoted to making our democracy thrive by making sure Latinos participate, becoming citizens, becoming voters, becoming elected officials, becoming effective elected officials. So we care about education for two principal reasons. One is the largest share of our membership are education policymakers. There are school board members, community college trustees elected to run educational institutions. Number two, a democracy cannot succeed, cannot thrive without an educated citizenry. So education not just is key to everything that we've been talking about, it's key to our democracy and making it work. So that's why we get involved in this, and I would be remiss if, as a head of a nonprofit, I don't thank those institutions and organizations. They help make our work possible. So Lumina Foundation, Gates Foundation, Univision, State Farm, all are great partners in the work we do on education. Now, one thing about the statistics, and I think they've been covered enough already by the earlier panel and by Esther's opening remarks. Two things I wanted you to remember about when we talk about Latinos being one in six Americans, being 50.5 million Latinos, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Two things to remember about those numbers. Number one, those numbers already are a year old. Those were the numbers as of April 1st, 2010. Number two, those numbers do not reflect the undercount of the Latino population in this country. As much as we are impressed by those numbers, and we did all we could at NALEO with our partner organizations to make every single Latino be counted, we know we missed them. We don't know how many, but I can assure you, we missed over a million Latinos in this census. So keep that in mind as we talk about this. So I'm not going to introduce our panel either, because you have their bios or describe them, but I will introduce them and their titles, and then we'll get into a conversation with them on the issue of accountability as we talk about education. We have with us John Mockler. He's the former executive director of the California State Board of Education and was an interim secretary of education here in California. We have David Sanchez, president of the California Teacher Association, former member. We have Maria Elena Yepes, member of the Los Angeles County Board of Education. Suzanne Elise Walsh, Senior Policy Program Officer, Post-Secondary Improvement with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And you met Jose Rico earlier this afternoon's panel with the White House Initiative on Educational Excellence for Hispanic Americans. Right?
That's right.
Okay. So I want to start where the last panel left off. And Deborah, I think, made this point. Observing how at a time of great budget cuts and budget cuts to education specifically, it's coming at a time when certainly the largest number of children in our K-12 schools in states like Texas and California are the majority of the children in those schools, but also becoming the majority of the students that should be going to college. So this is happening at the same time that we're having this crisis in funding and the cuts being made to education. So my first question to each of the panelists, is it a coincidence?
No.
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 I have to look at my colleague. You know, do I have to say yes or no? I want to hear more.
You want to hear more? Okay, I'll give you a pass on that.
That's a good answer.
That's a good answer.
No, I yeah.
You're taking a pass too?
Yeah, yeah.
All right. So three of you say it is not a coincidence that at the time that Latinos are becoming such a larger share of our college-going, school-going population in this country, that we're making cuts in education. Two of you want to observe more about that. That's exactly what this panel is about, then discussing the accountability, holding accountable those institutions for the education of this. So I'm going to go to government, because education, largely public education, is a government function in this country. Mm-hmm. Are we failing?
Well, yes. I mean, it's clear that we're failing. I think, you know, one of the things that that we talk a lot about is how the education system has been designed, both for trying to teach a group of homogeneous students with a set calendar and a set curriculum and a set outcome that and a set funding formula for every student. And even though the face of those students have changed dramatically, that has not changed. So I think that we are, and I think what we've been pretty clear in the last couple of years is trying to give some funding opportunities for more innovation, for more ways to try to change that, in a way for us to try to shake things up.
Well, John here disagrees with you. He says we're not failing.
Yeah, I think there's incredible evidence to the contrary. I can only talk about California because I don't have any great thoughts about America or the world. I only look at California data and I say, my pronouncement would be, we've made incredible progress, but when you look at the data, we're still way behind where we ought to be. So the question is, if we can make that much progress under these conditions, I would assert that the progress made, especially by Latino kids in high-end math and science over the last 7 years, in eighth grade algebra, I mean, we have five times as many Latino kids in California proficient or advanced in algebra than we had 7 years ago. We have twice as many proficient or advanced in physics, chemistry, mathematics of all sorts, biology. Is that enough? Well, you know, the number increase is good, but remember, just because I tell you how much I grow or how much I shrink doesn't tell me how tall I am. So if you look at Latino achievement, we start with 20% of the Latinos were proficient or advanced in reading, language, arts when we started an accountability system in California in 2003. That number doubled in 7 years.
But it's
still
enough.
Only 40%.
And it's not enough.
No, absolutely.
Okay. Let's hear from the county. L.A. County, if the eye of the storm had an eye of the storm, L.A. County would be the eye of the storm that is California.
Okay.
So L.A. County has a particular responsibility in terms of educating Latino children. How are we doing here?
Well, I think, you know, first of all, the children in elementary school are the majority, Latinos are the majority, Latinos and Latinas, in LA County schools. So one of the things that I am pushing for and have been pushing for, not just as a member of the county board, but as a full-time faculty member at East Los Angeles College and a member of two education collaboratives that work closely with East Los Angeles College, is the reclassification of English language learners. And what that means is that the students who are learning English as a second language need to be moved into the track where they are considered native speakers in order for them to have access to college-going culture. It is a fact that if the students are not moved into that area, they do not have access to college classes, they will probably not do well in school, and they lose interest. They lose interest at a higher rate than the other students. Why? Because all they're learning is English and math, and that's all they're allowed to do. And so reclassification is extremely important, and it's extremely important in LA County, because as I said, the majority of the children are Latinos and Latinas, and we have a third of them who are English language learners in the county. So you absolutely have to have reclassification in order for them to have access to a college-going culture that includes mathematics.
In the conversation about accountability, mm-hmm. Much of the focus has been on teachers mm-hmm. and the need for quality teachers and holding accountable teachers and making sure that every child has an effective teacher. At times, the teaching industry has been faulted for not promoting the highest standards among its workforce. How do we get to a point, David, where we have a high-quality teacher in every classroom?
Well, that's to assume that we don't have high-quality teachers right now.
In every classroom?
Not in every classroom, in all of our classrooms. To assume that teachers today aren't doing the best that they possibly can with the resources that they have to provide the optimum education for the students that we have in our classroom. I mean, we just had this discussion with the superintendent from Coachella and one of our teachers who teaches in the state. My God, am I the only one who's thinking about the possibility that there may not be a public education if we don't have this budget that has to be passed mm-hmm. and get this governor to get the tax extensions passed? We lost 30,000 teachers last year, within the last 2 years, 30,000 teachers, 20,000 more teachers have been given pink slips. And if this governor doesn't get his budget passed, 20,000 more teachers will not be returning to the classroom. You're talking about providing the best possible education that we can for all of our children, not just our Latino students, all of our children, with increased class sizes. I'm going to be going back to a kindergarten class with 40 children in that classroom. And you want to hold me accountable because with 40 kids and no resources and no funding and no counseling, and they've eliminated counselors in Fontana, 40, gone. So you talk about counseling ratios to counselors, what counselors? Right. You talk about art and music, no more. You talk about librarians or libraries, mm-hmm. no more. You want to hold me accountable? Yes, I am accountable. Our teachers in the state are accountable for what's happening in our programs. But you know what, folks? Starting this coming September, there may be some schools in the state of California that will not open their doors. In fact, we've been told that there's some schools that will not open their doors because of this budget mess that we're going through right now. It's a shame. We should be all talking about how do we get this governor the help that he needs to get two Republican votes on either house to pass the budget with the tax extensions that we need just to keep where we're at today. We're not even talking about the future. Right. Mm-hmm. You're talking about race to the top? Mm-hmm. Are you kidding me?
And the budget crisis extends at all levels of government.
Everywhere.
The state, the local,
we can't,
the
Fed. We can't meet the needs
of race
to the top.
We may even have a federal
top.
Government shutdown. Let me go to, don't worry. I love the passion.
You've got to say that. Yes.
I want to stay on the issue of effectiveness in teaching because that has been a key focus of the Gates Foundation. You just heard some impassioned remarks about teachers who are trying to do the best they can, but when they're faced with having a classroom of 40 students, feeling that they can't deliver on their profession. How does the Gates Foundation look at this?
So I work on he told me I have to move with the mic. Okay. So I work on the post-secondary side, so I'm sort of after the K-12 piece, but we're thinking about teachers as well. We're actually starting to think about faculty. And I think that this has become a really interesting area. So one of the things that we heard at Achieving the Dream, which someone just had mentioned a little bit earlier, was a speaker said, you cannot have curriculum change without pedagogy change, and you cannot have pedagogy change without curriculum change, which is really powerful for us in higher ed because we've spent a lot of time focusing on all kinds of other institutional changes, and we've actually been quite scared of talking with folks in the classroom. And so this is really an emerging area for us, but we're thinking about it in conjunction oftentimes with our colleagues, we call it college ready, but in our K-12 area, how can we think about faculty in a way that we can support them to support students? Ultimately, our goal is always we want students to be more successful. Mm-hmm. So I don't, you know, I can't, unfortunately, I'm sorry, I can't speak directly to the K-12 piece, but I do know that we have an incredibly focused interest now in saying we have to help faculty members in higher education help more students to be successful. And I have a question for you on, can I ask a question?
Of me?
Of the panel. Well, because one of the
panel.
Things...
Okay.
Well, but one of the things we're struggling with is really as we see students changing, right? We've been talking so much about increased numbers of Latino students in the classroom. Is there something that we should be doing differently around what we're offering students, what that experience is? Because we haven't changed it much. I mean, a lot of my portfolio is about redesigning the system. So I'm also curious, as we talk about... faculty, I'm also curious, how do faculty perhaps respond differently to this changing demographic? Because you can't just keep doing the same thing.
Right, and I think that's an excellent question. But let's talk about it in the context of higher ed.
Okay.
Is the traditional model of higher education that we have in this country, is that sustainable? Or do we need to rethink higher education in order to achieve our goals as a society? John?
Oh, yeah, we have to rethink it. Yeah, we cannot. The K-12 system, by whatever definition we have been using, has about a 30% increase in the number of kids, quote-unquote, qualified to go to CSU or above over the last 7 years. 30% increase. The number who actually were allowed to go to those institutions because of budget cutbacks or whatever is minus 5%. So we wind them up and run them right into the wall. Now, there's not going to be a manna from heaven. God is not going to give us $12 billion tomorrow on top of whatever else we have. So if you accept that notion, then we do have to begin to rethink how we will deliver quality, competent education, especially in the post-secondary world, in models that are different and differently interactive than we have today. Now, if you say that real quick, it sounds good. It's really hard work.
That's right.
It's really hard work.
It's hard work. How's the White House and the Department of Education looking at rethinking higher education?
So, you know, one of the things that we've been doing that we've been fortunate is we've been working with presidents of different universities to give us some of those suggestions, right? And so we've actually taken some presidents from universities over to meet with some of the top policy planners, with Roberto Rodriguez and Carmel Martin, to give us their ideas of what are some changes. Some things that have come up that have been great is, you know, in higher ed, they will lack more accountability. One suggestion that they made is, why isn't there a Title I, like the ESEA Title I? Why isn't there a Title I for higher ed and hold us to the same accountability standards? Why is it that certain Pell monies and certain grants go to universities that have hardly any accountability? And why don't you limit the number of Pell money and grants, loan money that they receive, when they cannot produce students? Mm-hmm. So some of those leaders have come to us and pitched some of these ideas because they welcome the accountability, but also, obviously, in these hard times, feel that we're wasting resources in universities that are not using it effectively. So for us, our role really is trying to connect with those people that are meeting these challenges in the front lines and giving us advice for a lot of the things that are coming up at the table.
In terms of rethinking higher education, there was a question that was asked from the audience earlier, and as I heard it, it was not talking about public versus private institutions, which is how the previous panel responded, but they're talking about for-profit institutions. Mm-hmm. And certainly there's been a proliferation mm-hmm. of universities that are in it to make a buck mm-hmm. off of our kids. Mm-hmm. Is there a role for-profit institutions in meeting our higher education needs?
Yeah, Thank you, Arturo. Yes, definitely. And I'm a full-time faculty member at East Los Angeles College, a public institution. But we have dialogue with for-profits that are in the community that want to provide health classes that are not available on our college. And this is a brand new initiative because the college is about to embark on opening a health sciences outlet, a campus, so that all of our health sciences students go there, you know, and they can feel that they're in a college environment. So as part of that, we have started a dialogue with for-profits. There's nothing wrong with a for-profit, provided that, number one, they are honest with their students and ethical about what they can and cannot provide. If they're promising jobs and they cannot provide jobs, that is not correct. If their courses do not transfer to a four-year college or university, they need to say that. Because the students, a lot of times, who have started at these for-profits and do get certificates, at a later point in time, once they're professionals, they want to go into a college or university, and then they find out they can't do it because the courses that they took are not transferable. So, and then the other part is that they should also be honest about how much federal money they are using in order to, and how, what kind of recruitment practices are they using to bring in students, you know? So those are the areas of concern. But again, if the for-profit is ethical, because we have private universities and we do work with them all the time. So if the for-profit is ethical, if they're honest.
They don't consider themselves out for a profit.
You do foundations, you do other things. The other part is, you know, if they portray themselves honestly, mm-hmm. then we want to partner with them. You know, I mean, that's the main issue.
Let me go
us.
Back to John on this. John, when you were Secretary of Education, how did the state look at the role of for-profits in meeting the higher education needs in the state?
I think the state was actually overly generous. We had a big teacher shortage, for example. And the privates, your national universities, for example, Phoenix, et cetera, produced an incredibly new number of teachers. And that was very helpful. And we had some grants coming out of Cal Grant. We expanded those grants for kids to become teachers. So there was a good thing there. We didn't get this distinction that we didn't do as well with, which she was making, which is, yeah, but you got to make sure you're delineating properly. Privates have a great role to be played, but you got to look at outcomes. But you have to do that in public side too. Mm-hmm. But I think if you look at the growth in production of teachers in California, for example, the privates are the largest growing segment. PhDs in education, largest segment.
Let me go to David on that point. Yeah. David, how does CTA or how do you view rethinking higher education in the state?
We would really like to see more resources given statewide to our, you know, our state university system and our UC system. Knowing how challenging stuff, you know, times are right now, and where it's almost impossible for our students to even get into a community college because now we've capped the number of students that can get into a community college. The for-profit universities, John was right. I'm a graduate of the University of Laverne where I got my master's and my administrative credential, and there's a role for them if they're, as you were saying, honest about the program they can deliver. But my God, I'm thinking about how expensive it must be today to try and go to school in those particular institutions.
But I think we could learn a lot from, you know, that's the publics right. could learn a lot in terms of how they customize the curriculum,
yes.
how they use technology. And I think that's one of the lessons that the large universities could learn, the state universities and other universities could learn about the marketing that they do. Again, that still does not address the challenge of the funding, right? Because you have mm-hmm. You have some limited seats, but you could potentially reach a greater audience and educate more people with a modest investment in technology and other means.
So let me throw this back to you, Suzanne. Mm-hmm. You asked the question. What did you hear?
Oh, my gosh. Well, you know, I mean, I think it's very interesting. I think it's very consistent with the kinds of things that we're thinking about in terms of how do we learn from for-profits? You can't learn from all of them. Right. You know, let's focus on the ones that we've heard that are in the best position. But the other thing that we really have to think about is all morning we heard about this this huge goal that we're all willing to take on in terms of more people with credentials and degrees. We don't have enough seats. I mean, California is the prime example. You are turning away students constantly. Where else are they going to go? So I think what happens is if they are willing to be, you know, ethical and so forth, that's a great alternative for some students. It's an expensive alternative, but it's an alternative. And I think this capacity question is really important. But I don't think it really sort of got at my point about are there things that we need to do differently for new populations of students? In other words, when people talk about traditional students, they ordinarily say, you know, they're 18, they've gone straight from college. You know, we kind of heard that on the previous panel. And what we're starting to say is non-traditional is the new traditional.
Right.
And so that includes students of color. It includes English language students. It includes all of these things that I'm not sure that higher ed is adjusting to. How do we serve this new group of students? And so part of the portfolio that I work in is focused on redesigning higher ed. We're really interested in how can you change that student experience from the first time they step on campus, where they're just even trying to decide, do I want to go to college? Ooh, this is scary. All the way through to completion. What can you do that's very, very different for that student so they keep on track? You know, the other question that you had asked about failure, mm-hmm. I think is interesting because the report that Excelencia did said that from 2000 to 2005, the gap between Latinos and whites was a 10% gap in completion rates, and then the following year it was up to 14%. We're doing something that's why I'm saying, what can we do that maybe is a bit more targeted?
This is a very important intellectual issue and a content issue and lots of different issues at once.
Yeah.
We learned so much between when we started having an assessment system and we started measuring progress and looking at what students did and didn't. We learned a lot, and we learned a lot about Latino students and English learners between 2002 and 2008. A huge amount. We learned that we weren't providing academic English to those kids. We learned that those kids had needed more time.
How did we learn it? What changed?
We learned that by analyzing the assessment scores of English learners over a period of 5 years, we discovered. And we set about to fix it. And we provided a whole new set of materials for the K-12 system, instructional materials, K-8, that actually focused on that for both those kids and African-American kids. And that at just that time, the state decided, forget those lessons, use the old materials, we can't afford the new ones. and we know that if these kids, you can teach them to read, but you can't teach them to get college bound unless you get into this academic English instruction thing. You've probably known this for years, and the rest of us just caught up.
David, you're having some responses to that.
I'm just thinking.
I have your attention. The time is now 4:34. Library service ends.
Could have been worse. Could have been a fire drill.
Is that because of the cuts?
Uh-oh.
Yeah, there we go. It's not even 5.
I know.
All right, David, I saw you nodding there.
I was just thinking.
They are serious.
Okay.
How nice.
All right.
I can speak over. Okay. Yeah. I'm a classroom teacher. I was just thinking, I love this conversation that we're having about higher ed and getting our children ready to go to college. Mm-hmm. But I have to tell you that as a classroom teacher, you know, for 30 years, what are we going to do about our children who aren't going to go to college? Mm-hmm. To assume that everybody is going to go to college? I mean, we want everyone to go to college. We do. But what about my kids in my classroom who aren't? Just because, as you said, they have the questioning whether or not they can go out. Hopefully they can get at least 2 years mm-hmm. under their belt in a community college system. That'd be ideal. Mm-hmm. But what about those kids that aren't? Don't we care about them? Of course we do. But just you know, our conversation today is assuming that everyone is going to go to college. I'm lucky I grew up in an environment where both my parents were teachers. Not everyone's growing up that way.
But I think that we should have that expectation that and when we say college,
well,
we
shouldn't
are,
college be an option?
Exactly. Well, I don't think so. I mean, I don't think college should be an option. I mean, I think if we're talking about the 21st century and what we mean by college, we shouldn't just mean a 4-year liberal arts degree, right? We're investing billions and billions of dollars in the community college system to make sure that a two-year degree, mm-hmm. a nine-month certificate, mm-hmm. that everybody needs to have mm-hmm. that piece of paper. And whether it's, starting there, we know that once students are successful with those 9 months, adults, along with the kids that graduate from high school, that should be the expectation. I think what we need to do is to really expand our definition of what college means.
Mm-hmm. And that's part, oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, and that's part of our goal on our post-secondary team within the Gates Foundation is we're interested in both credentials and degrees. And so the credentials are those shorter certificates. I think mm-hmm. the other thing to think about is what are the ways that you can use dual enrollment more effectively so that the students are gaining those skills? Virginia actually has done some very interesting things in terms of while a student is in high school, they're taking community college courses that are leading to a certificate. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of times dual degree isn't on that path.
Right.
So starting to rethink that and think about it in more of this kind of applied way, I think, is a great question.
Mm-hmm. We're going through triage in California. Mm. Triage. I love the notion that everybody's going to go to college or 60% or whatever number by whatever year. But, you know, we started off 4 years ago with half as many teachers per kid in our high schools as the average high school in America. We have 75% fewer counselors in our high schools than the average. Average. I'm not talking about New York or places that spend real money. That was 4 years ago. Since that time, we have cut annual expenditures for K-12 and community colleges by $9 billion. $9 billion. Below those numbers that we started out with. Mm-hmm. We're into triage, folks. We're not going to be meeting any of those goals.
So talking about accountability, where's the outrage?
I don't know where the outrage is. It should be there because the outrage should be on total, but it also should be distributional. I mean, just because you may have less doesn't mean you'd have, you know, more whites succeeding and less Latinos. I mean, the thing is equity. I mean, I don't want every kid to be qualified to go to University of California, but I think there's just as many highly qualified Latino kids, the upper 12.5% should go, but not 100%.
Right.
So there's two issues going on here. One is we're going to be into triage. We're going to have to lower our sights. And then within that, we're going to have to figure out distributions because we apparently are not prepared. We're not prepared to go back to where we were.
Let me get you into this conversation, mm-hmm. Marielena.
Sure. Well, two things. One, you know, to answer David's question about what about the kids that are not going to go to college. As community colleges, we want to provide that bridge always. So first of all, accountability for community colleges. I think that the focus when people do studies on community colleges is much too narrow. You know, they say, okay, if the students didn't transfer, the community colleges are failing. Mm-hmm. But what they don't understand is that we do, in California, we have multiple missions. And we have multiple missions because I thought that was a very good plan from the education plan in the state of California, which is some people just need to upgrade their skills for work. Other people came here to learn English. Other people are there because in the process, they don't know what they want to do. So they use the community college as an experience for figuring out what do they want to do with their lives. It's their opportunity to reinvent themselves, whether they graduated from high school in June or they graduated 5 years ago and all of a sudden decided they wanted to go back.
I'd like you to respond to a mm-hmm. point that was made in the earlier panel. I think it was Michelle who made the point that the community college system was the most overregulated system.
Yes.
How would you reimagine mm-hmm. community colleges then?
Well, first, I think that we do need, in this aspect, I agree that we need more robust data. And because of funding situations, not all community colleges have their internal institutional effectiveness offices that can do that, collect that data on all the students who came to us and actually are somewhere now, but we don't know where they are. Even those that declare that they're going to transfer, we have like a transfer ceremony and so on at the college, but we never know exactly where they ended up. And in order for us to do that, we can go to UCLA and say, how many of our ELAC students came to you? And they say, well, can you provide us with the names? And then we can tell you if they're here.
They don't know
either, you know? So I think that that's a big gap that somebody can help with, mm-hmm. you know? In other words,
And that's certainly an area, I think, where the federal government could help, which is to help us all string ourselves together data-wise so that we know where did our students end up.
Well, the community college establishment opposed every effort at the state level to have a common system of data for community colleges like we have in K-12 because we didn't used to measure this stuff.
Right.
And guess what? Kids got dropped through the cracks. When we didn't measure who was taking algebra, guess who didn't take algebra? Mm-hmm. Guess who didn't take it? Once we started measuring, people started doing it. So we need measurement systems, not to be mean, but just to focus on the system. Mm-hmm. And so, community colleges just don't like that. Now, CSU doesn't like it worse.
Let me go to Jose on this, because No Child Left Behind, hopefully it's going to get reauthorized. There's been no action on it. There was no action on it in the last Congress. Higher Education Act is up for reauthorization. Does the administration have a position in terms of this data collection requirements that we saw in No Child Left Behind being replicated in the Higher Education Act?
Yeah, so you know, we started working on it earlier last year, and definitely, I mean, basically, a big part of our plan is being able to use data. You actually could see what we are looking for in some of the grants that have come out of labor, and then also recently with our upcoming HSI grants. The reality of the fact, and I was telling Deborah this earlier, is that right now, with the Pell Grant money and the gainful employment stuff, those are the things that we're focusing on, and we want to be able to make sure that No Child Left Behind gets reauthorized because of two things. We want to increase the funding for it, and we want to make sure that we stop being as punitive with schools. So that's really what we're putting a lot of our focus on.
Okay, I saw some raised eyebrows from David.
Oh, my God. We put a stop to the last reauthorization of No Child Left Behind 4 years ago when, at that time, President Bush wanted to reauthorize it way back when. It was even more restrictive back then than what they wanted to do. Then looking at the blueprint, this new one that's coming out could be even more restrictive than what we currently have. And so although we appreciate being, you know, someone said being invited to the table, yeah, we're invited to the table because we're making ourselves be at the table to have these discussions on what the federal government is going to impose on districts, not give them an opportunity to be part of the discussion, but to tell them, this is what you're going to do. This is how we're going to deal with schools that aren't performing. You know, we're not even talking about proven reform with the four measured options that they give us on what to do when schools aren't performing. That's if they really aren't performing. And I roll my eyes about No Child Left Behind because these people, what were they smoking when they thought that everyone by 2014 is going to pass a single standardized test? Everybody? Come on.
All of God's children are above average.
Oh, yes.
Amen. Marilena.
You know, and I think that this punitive assessment model is not working. It works in a very narrow way, you know. It's good to get our butts kicked and make us, right, and have us make a push, you know, so that we have some goals. But the best practices that are out there are not being replicated, and they should be replicated nationally. Even throughout California, we have some tremendous, long-standing best practices, like the Puente program, like, you know, accelerated programs for accelerated college education for working adults, learning communities, small schools models. Mm-hmm. There are so many things, and they're not being replicated. And those are the best practices that we could use massively and nationally to lift all of us, you know, and especially our Latino students. And reclassification models, the dual language schools, you know, more and more dual language schools are raising here in California, are being developed, and they're working very well. And the teachers want to be there. And I think that engaged students are there because they're engaged with their teachers. And we keep forgetting that we can't have students without teachers. And so I really think that going along with a punitive model is a very restricted way of doing the job. And actually, that is what continues to promote cuts, I think. Because they say, okay, this isn't working, so we're going to cut it. But they're not looking at everything else that does work. And then you get to the point where even your best practices don't no longer work because there's no support for them. So those are some of my thoughts, you know, insofar as how we are doing and what we're doing. Mm-hmm. And yes, you know, even without, in many cases, without money, there are a lot of things that we can do, you know, to, in the case of East Los Angeles College, what we decided to do in order to help students graduate was to move in deeper. So we have middle school programs, we have high school programs, we have some in-depth programs with 22 of our feeder high schools.
And you're able to do that without additional resources?
Some resources we do have. We have federal money, mm-hmm. you know, we have grants, we have private foundations. We had to in order for us to do that. But that's our commitment from the college, and I'm sure we're not the only college that is doing that.
I'd like to see you guys get the government money to run those programs and let the foundations go help the Defense Department.
I didn't even know I was going to get advice while I was here. I don't even know where to go. But I actually had a couple of thoughts. I mean, I think one, we have a phrase that we talk about in terms of testing, which is we'd like to build confidence back into the test. And by that, I think that really will take some working together about what's the right sort of testing that we do. And so I can only speak to the post-secondary side of testing. But I think that it's sort of the same idea. And what we hear over and over again for the placement test, I don't know how many people in this room had to take remedial anything, math or English? Oh yes, okay. Do you even remember taking a placement test that got you there? Did you know what the placement test meant?
Yep.
Some people did, some people don't. And what we find is it's not a great test. It, there are some of you who probably shouldn't have been in remedial math, but you were there because it decided you pass or you fail. Mm-hmm. There's no diagnostic to it. And I think that's sort of the same thing that we're trying to figure out, in that whole discussion about testing is how can it be a valuable resource? And so at the higher ed level, it's so interesting because it's called the placement test. And in working with our colleagues on our K-12 side, I heard them calling it an assessment. And I said, ooh, that's kind of good, because that's what we want. We want to be able to provide diagnostic information back to the student and to the faculty member that says more than just I passed or I failed. It will say something about, you know what, I didn't get fractions. And that was the only thing I didn't get. I just didn't get fractions. What? So back to redesigning the system, then why do I have to sit mm-hmm. through an entire Very semester? Mm-hmm. Or you could be like my husband, who he took the test and he was like, you know, Suzanne, you got to do a prep class for your law school exam, prep class for your bar exam, you know, all these prep courses that I had before I took an exam. And he said, that didn't exist for me before I took the placement test. Some of you, if you were just reminded about how to do fractions, yeah. you would have been fine. You're like, oh, right, I remember that. But you haven't used those skills in a while. So on testing, I think it's just how do we build confidence back for the student and for the institutions. And then the other thing I just wanted to quickly comment on was this idea about data use. And I think what's interesting about that is there's one of our colleagues who's an economist has been thinking about this issue about we all went to the same high school, but we went to different colleges, and we all sort of were the same kind of student in high school. We all perform very differently at those colleges. What is it about certain colleges that are better at serving all of us? I mean, it's kind of, or each of us. It's a very, very interesting question. I think that's a very important kind of data to look, piece of data, because you could actually help students to be more successful if you knew, you know what? If you went to name your favorite school, you're actually going to do better there than if you went to the neighboring school. That's important information, I think, for families to have. And the other thing that I think is interesting is in Miami, at Miami-Dade Community College, or Miami-Dade College, they are sending data about how students are doing back to the high school to say, just wanted to let you know, here's how many students are placing into developmental ed, here's how many are college ready. And it started a conversation, not a blaming conversation, but just a how do we plan on this together. So I think that there are alternative ways to use data that are not punitive, but are really something that we can actually plan for in the future.
That's a very good point, because data should be used to tell you, for us as a classroom teacher, mm-hmm. how well or what our children need in order to be able to move
That's
on
right.
to the next step. Data should not have ever been used under Race to the Top to compare me as a classroom teacher to my other colleague, to another, to the school, to the district, to the state. The gentleman that just mentioned that education is a right, not a race. That's exactly what we've been doing. We're racing because you're comparing my school or my classroom to everybody else. When my classroom, 90% of my kids don't speak English. And you're going to hold me accountable, the same set of accountability to a classroom that has 70% of their children are fluent English speakers?
What do you think about that?
Let me erase the top. There's another assessment component that when you answer the question about can we deliver a test in English and Spanish, under Race to the Top, there's two consortiums that have been given awarded funding under Race to the Top to develop a new assessment component for K-12 schools. One is called PARC. The other one's called Smarter Balance. And each state has to decide which of the two consortiums they're going to go with. Now, the clincher to the assessments is that it's going to be computer test only, no longer a paper pencil test. And it's going to be done in one language, and this has to be done starting 2014. So if you look in your classrooms today to see how many classrooms have computers, and by 2014 we're going to deliver this kind of assessment, which the thought is good, is to use that also to see how well kids are doing on a computer in one language. But they're going to also use that same test to evaluate how I'm doing as a classroom teacher when that's not what the test was designed to do.
Let me throw this to Jose, sure. Because race to the top.
So as you know, there's also funds to be able to develop a Spanish assessment, and it's up to the states to use it. And I'm assuming California is probably not going to use that assessment, right, because of your state laws.
No, we use.
So there is funds to be able to do that, and that's something that's been in development.
But in what subject?
In the subjects that are going to be tested.
You're going to test English, language, arts, and Spanish.
Right. No. In the subjects that are going to be tested. So whatever the Common Core curriculum and whatever accountability. But
wouldn't English be one of them?
Like English, language, arts.
Well, you can't do an English test in Spanish.
What do you mean?
Well, you can give a Spanish test in Spanish, but you can't give an English
with the
test.
Content. We're talking about the content, right? So one of the things that we want to be able to do with the accountability in terms of the test scores is not look at an absolute number, but look at growth, right? And so that's really the big push for us, is to look at growth. So it's not just of where your students are here and you're going to be penalized, but really looking at growth and being able to use that tool for growth.
In California, we have a growth model, but it includes history, it includes science. You know, not enough, but it does include it. And the feds now tell us, well, we can't use that.
No.
Right, under current law, you can't use it. It's only math and English language arts.
All right. Another point that was brought up in the earlier panel, and I had to give more another shout out to Michelle on this. Did you know Michelle worked at Naleo?
conspiracy. Big plug. Conspiracy.
She talked about the need for courage in leadership. Before we throw it open to the audience for Q&A, let's talk a little bit about how do we develop this courage in leadership to make the changes in higher ed and to achieve these goals that we keep talking about. Mm-hmm. If you could change something to bring that courage out, what would it be?
Wow. Courage is so accessible in the abstract, but there's no measurement for it, so it's difficult. It's like we always have tried to write a law about what is a good principal, which really is a courageous,
right,
intelligent,
committed, right,
academically trained individual. But try to test for that. We don't know how to do it. I don't know how to do it.
David?
I guess find people who are not afraid to try and make decisions that are for the greater good of all of our students.
Mm-hmm. How?
Well, she said it right. You know, we occasionally need to have our butt kicked to force us to do things differently, you know, and to assume that, you know, educators are not willing to do that is not true. We welcome change. We welcome the opportunity to do things differently because we're in this for the good of our students. We want our students to be successful so they can go into higher ed, whatever their goals are. But it's a big challenge.
Marilena?
Personal accountability. I think that, you know, You want to look at people that want leadership so that they can be accountable to their constituents. And so that as they look at the big picture and the greater good, which is what is good for our children, what is good for our youth, and therefore what is good for our country,
that they are willing to look at themselves and say, what am I doing personally to move that goal forward in my role as a policy developer, in my role as a policy implementer, in my role as a classroom teacher, whatever it is. But you need people that are willing to be personally accountable.
I think it has to do with leading by example and then shining the light on those examples. And so I think about, in particular, a student who I met, well, he's no longer a student, but a gentleman who I met in Texas who was involved in a lot of gang-related problems as a youth, dropped out of high school, went on to get his GED, joined the military, and ultimately went to college and is now leading the education department at a community college in Texas. And the reason that I see him as a really interesting leader is because this gentleman reaches back to other Latinos who are involved in GED and says, you know, you actually have the ability to come forward. You can do this too. You could get a PhD. You can go from GED to PhD. And I think that being able to tell his story and to tell other students' stories, at least in the field of education and higher education, is a great way to show leadership. I mean, his own leadership took a chance on him. I mean, that's kind of an unusual route to becoming the department chair. But just being able to encourage leadership in others, as he does when he goes back and says to those GED guys, you can do it too, I think that makes a huge difference. Yeah.
You know, I think myself and a lot of people see a lot of courageous things. People do a lot of courageous things pretty often, whether it's a parent, a teacher, a community member. But I think that regardless of what level you're at, our organizations, our foundations, our institutions, we cannot support those folks for very long. And I think we don't have the flexibility, the innovation, the ganas more than anything to support somebody that does a courageous act and be with them for the long haul. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really more of a fault of us trying to survive and maintain the status quo where we're at. But when we see those acts of courage, and I know all of us could think of many right now, we're not set up to support them.
Yeah, and that's why, amidst all this, you still have to have some data systems to be transparent. So the public, who pays most of these bills, has a chance to look at what you're doing. Not to punish, but certainly to keep an eye on you. Yeah.
Okay. Let's open it up to you folks who join this conversation.
Thank you. My name is Raul de Quesada, and I'm with Fox Deportes here in Southern California. I'm going to make a couple of statements, and then I'm going to ask a question. The first statement is it's a
briefly.
Pretty... I'm sorry?
Briefly.
Briefly. It's a pretty sad day every day that I see that you turn on any media and they're blaming teachers for the failure in the system. I mean, they should be praising the teachers. I mean, teachers is probably the only strong remaining force that really can get us out of the mess that we're in. The second thing is, Marilena mentioned reclassification. I've been in this debate or conversation for a long time, and you're the first one that really addresses that. I truly feel that ESL is the worst thing that can happen to us Latinos. I think it's a direct correlation between ESL and failure to graduate and failure to go to college. Mm-hmm. That is something we really have to take a look at very carefully. And the question is, you know, why is it so popular to say, I'm in favor of education, but what is it so unpopular to really get together and find the best practices that you guys are talking about?
Okay, interesting question. Mm-hmm. Who wants? Marilena?
Sure. So why is it so hard to get together to find those best practices? It gets back to that data stringing that we don't have, you know, so for example, and actually there's another element to that. First, you know, the data is not easily available because it may be housed in some university, right? And most, how many people are going to go to that university website? Those who are maybe those who are interested in going there or those who are doing research. So that's a very small amount of people. The media doesn't have that information, you know, so that's one. Of the reasons. And the other one is that, again, you know, the public just doesn't know. They don't know what is going on If they're very involved in their own school and their school is innovative and creative, they know about that. But they don't know about anything else. So as much as we dedicate ourselves to education, I think that we ourselves as educators do a very poor job of letting people know what we do, you know? And so we have to think of ways to do it because, honestly, the commercial media is not going to do it.
You agree with that, David?
I would. And I would have to say that, you know, we can't, obviously, we can't compete with Oprah Winfrey.
Right.
We can't compete with Newsweek. We can't compete with, you know,
the
New York Times, Kardashians. Yeah, I mean, come on. Kardashians especially. But what we have to
do. An alien force in Star Trek?
What we have to do is to, and it's almost too late, but we've got to do this, is to communicate with the public about the hard work that classroom teachers do every day. Thank you for saying what you said about educators, because I know that our particular culture places a high value on educators, mm-hmm. you know. My parents, whenever I did parent conferences, God help the kid if they misbehaved in my class. Mm-hmm. Because I was the teacher, you do not misbehave mm-hmm. in his classroom. But that's not what's happening right now in the state. And we need to get back to that. We need to communicate, as she was saying, to the public about what's going on in our public schools.
Right. Other questions? Let's see. Well, if someone else hasn't asked a question, the lady in here. Welcome back.
Thank you. Sonia Martin Solis with the National Education Association Board of Directors and a teacher in Los Angeles. My question has to do with assessments and matching that to instruction. As a bilingual teacher in a second grade classroom, working with ELD kids, I'm expected to help translate, to help bring in what they already know in order to get instruction across. The assessment doesn't allow me to do any of that. So when students are used to being instructed in a certain way or getting certain supports on a day-to-day basis, and then here comes the CST, and, you know, God help you, I'll see you at the end of the light, or at the end of this tunnel, you know, hopefully you see the light and get to the end of that tunnel, that doesn't match what they know because that's not how they're used to performing. It's not how they're used to showing you, demonstrating to you, the teacher, how they have gathered the information. So is there any move toward the assessments actually matching the instruction that we as teachers are expected to provide for these students?
Assess. Yes, there is. I mean, I think that that's part of
one question.
Of the reasons why we want to be able to change that. And, you know, one of the things that we want to move to is being able to use less high-stakes tests and more of an interim assessments that could be more focused at the classrooms, that that teachers are able to develop based on the core standards, right? Mm-hmm. Computer-based, things that are done there. So from our point of view, the best information that you could receive on how your students is doing is based on what you're teaching those students that you can measure more regularly as an assessment tool versus a mm-hmm. high-stakes tool. Mm-hmm.
You know, I think the other thing that we're starting to see in higher education, and I think you're seeing it in K-12 as well. So in K-12, I think you guys talk about proficiency, and in higher ed, we call it competency-based learning. And I think it's a really interesting place to have the conversation that you're having now, because it gets at a student proving what they know, demonstrating, which is what you were saying, demonstrating what they know. And I think those conversations have to really come into the conversations about assessment. We're starting to think about it again at higher ed. What's the right way for a student to be able to demonstrate what they've learned? Because right now what happens is people just presume you know something because you have a degree. But often that degree didn't quite, you know, measure up to what you're actually doing in the workplace. So being able to show, I think, is a really important component of assessment in the future.
Next question. Yes, sir. Oh, where? Yes.
I actually have a question, but I also have a comment. So my name is Mildred, and I'm with the Bill Melinda Gates Foundation as well. And I, because my colleague works on the post-sec work, I wanted to just make sure to highlight a really exciting research project that we've taken on the K-12 side, which is called our MET project, which is Measuring Effective Teaching. And what we're actually doing, and Bill and Melinda are spending about $300 million to take this research. So we're actually trying to figure out what does effective teaching look like? And what are those things that effective teachers do that we could all learn from? And so right now, you know, you sit in a room and you try to figure out, I know people do this at the federal level, how do we do it? You know, so I've been hearing a lot of blaming and people feeling, you know, that everyone's blaming the teacher. But a lot of it is a lot of frustration from a lot of years of no increases in student achievement. And
that
so,
is not true.
Well,
so
fair enough.
I know the Gates Foundation publishes that nonsense, but to say there's been no increase in achievement, you've done it, your foundation does it daily, and it's an error, including Mr. Gates himself. There's been great increase in achievement, demonstrably, measured by whatever measure you want.
Okay. And so the NAEP scores that come out every year, those are not true?
The NAEP scores that come out every year.
The NAEP scores are not true?
What do the NAEP scores measure?
Student achievement?
No, they don't measure what we teach.
We can have a debate at another time. My point is still that one of the things that we're trying to actually do is to actually research what it means and what it means to be to do effective teaching in your classroom. Mm-hmm. And our goal from that is to actually help shine a light on the teachers that are being really effective. Because we cannot pretend. I think it's a lie to say that every teacher is effective. That is a lie. I think that anybody in this room could tell me that is, you know, whether or not that's a lie. And so what we want to do, though, is how do you help a teacher get better? I mean, no, everyone's like, let's accuse or let's do or let's have a debate about the data, but no one is saying, how are we going to help teachers get better? And so it's 3,000 teachers, 100,000 students in 5 cities across the United States. It's really exciting, and I encourage you all to go online and look at our website, because I think the important thing is we can have a debate about what a teacher evaluation system looks like, and we can pick and choose what we want to believe and what data we want to listen to, that everyone can have a research that's going to support whatever they want to say at the end of the day. But we're really going into this very methodically with teachers. Both the NEA and the AFT are participating and helping us at the local level. And we're really trying to find out, how do we help improve teachers in the classroom?
David,
and so,
David, what's your views on that?
We used to have a program in the state that I can't remember the name of it right now off the top of my head, but it was funded by the state. If there was a teacher that didn't do well on the evaluations, that we put them in program improvement. Mm-hmm. And we put them in a program improvement for a couple of years. That worked. Because it was teachers helping teachers to develop, at that time, you know, whatever the deficiency was in their teaching. We used to have that. Unfortunately, we don't have it anymore. Because it was cut, it's a budget cut, and therefore we don't have that program anymore to help our teachers who are struggling. And, you know, we're not going to say that, and I'd be the last person to admit that every teacher in the state of California is effective in doing the best they can. Because it's just like any other profession. My God. But the fact of the matter is that the blanket statement, all of us, and to say that we're not doing the best we can, you can't do that. You just can't.
Next question. Yes, sir.
Hello, I'm Peter Brown. I'm with Compass PR Group. There's been a lot of discussion today about leadership and testing, and particularly on the testing issue and the measure of teachers. I happen to have 3 daughters in elementary school. And they happen to go to a great school in West LA. And we raise a lot of money for that school.
Yep.
And that's something that poor schools do not get to do.
Exactly.
So I guess my question is, what are we really testing when we go about testing things? Mm-hmm. We've lost billions of dollars to education, elementary, K through 12, billions of dollars. And so we're going to go about measuring and testing. And so year after year, you lose resources. So what are you really testing, and how accurate are your measures when you're testing teacher effectiveness when you're losing billions of dollars of resources? When my second grader, who a couple years ago would have had 20 kids in her class, has close to 30 kids in her class, which means there's less time every single day for her to engage her teacher. And the disruptions that may happen with little kids in a larger class, even less time, every day. And that accumulates and builds up over the year. So are we really dealing with a class warfare issue here when we have less money going around? And it goes back to the original question. Is this intentional that we're divesting in education?
Absolutely.
And now there's an opportunity for private education to pop up and jump into the mix? There's my outrage. Sorry.
Yeah. Good. Very good point.
Very good point. Yeah.
Glad you have outrage. Everybody should have outrage.
No reactions to that?
Yes.
Yes, Marilena.
Thank you very much for your comments. And I wanted to say that
Here is a primary example of a crucial element that was raised in the previous panel that we cannot emphasize enough, and that's the parent engagement component in not just in participating in public education, but in saving public education. I think that we need to go beyond just, you know, although those are great, you know, the cookie sales and you know, the hot dog sales and everything else. And in some cases, you know, where the parents have means much deeper than cookie sales and hot dog sales. But we also need that fervor to turn into anger to change the policies in this state, I mean, in this country. I mean, when parents start speaking and they start going before boards, boards listen. You know, believe me, they listen. Parents have an incredible voice in this process. And students do too, but students need the backing of parents and the community in order to be able to do something. And the question about what is it that we're testing, exactly, that is the question. In other words, if all we are doing is looking at linear measurements, which is exactly what goes on, you know, with the different state tests that we have, then we don't see everything else that is going on and all the promise that is included in each classroom across the state. When you have children lighting up because, again, they have a wonderful teacher that they can relate to. And no, not all teachers are great, but if they're in the classroom, they're there for a reason. And a lot of times, whether it is because they are overregulated or because they have, unfortunately, a principal, a leader that is not a very effective leader, or whatever it is, teachers, like any other profession, they burn out. And if they burn out, then they're just there. You know, so the program that David was talking about is a very important program, and those things should come back. And the reason that that program doesn't exist anymore is because it does require extra funding. Mm-hmm. We need to talk about programs that don't require extra funding and programs that do require extra funding. And that's where the honesty piece comes in with each of us when we're looking at education as educators, you know. And this is one piece that definitely needed the extra funding in order to put teachers through professional development. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, clamoring as you do as a parent, we need everybody across the state to do that, in order for us to be able to bring back the educational system that we once had and make it even better with a 21st century emphasis on 21st century skills, because that's where we're at now and our students deserve that. So thank you for your comments.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
You have the microphone, you get to ask the question.
Thank you. Jared Sanchez with the Alliance for a Better Community. I guess I have a two-part question. The first is, do higher education teacher preparation programs adequately prepare aspiring teachers for the realities of the modern-day classroom?
Great.
So dealing with urban schools, special education students, English learners, and, of course, dealing with the bureaucracy. that's the first part of the question. Mm-hmm. The second is, what are they doing well, and how can they improve?
Yeah. So just there's a couple of teacher education programs that are actually doing a great job. Well, there's more than a couple. There's a few. The one example I want to mention is, you know, Arizona State University just made a huge change to their teacher education program, where basically the president and the dean said, if you know you need to be proficient in math and science, their entry scores are the highest entry scores at the campus, and it said if you can't do math and science, go be a lawyer. We need the best here in the teacher education program. And so those are pretty good programs where they also do one-year residencies instead of a shorter nine-week residency. And they pair do the mentorship mm-hmm. while the student is a student before they go out and teach.
Yes.
I just think final is they really prepare teachers with the mission of every child can learn, and I'm going to do everything I can and bring all the people around me to do everything I can. And they send people out in cohorts, not as individual teachers all over the districts, but they put them in cohorts with people that have been trained in the same way so they could support each other when they graduate. So there's some great programs that are doing
it. We had a couple of those programs in California. We just fired 50,000 teachers that came out of them from our public school.
Are we preparing our teachers, our prospective teachers, while they're in the higher ed, in our institutions of higher ed, to the realities of what's happening in the classroom or whatever, you know, whatever educational realm they're in? No. Because now our teachers are, we used to say, in my speeches 10 years ago, I used to say we need 100,000 new teachers within the next 10 years. Now, with 30,000 teachers we lost 2 years ago and 20,000 that are going to possibly lose their jobs come the next school year, our teachers are not prepared to possibly lose their jobs when they come into the profession. So why go in to the teaching profession if you're going to possibly lose your job and keep losing your job for about 5 years? They're not being prepared for reality.
Thank you. I wanted to, follow David's comments with the spiral effect that we're seeing as a result of the budget cuts.
Yes.
Because very recently, I received an announcement from another community-based organization, the Boyle Heights Learning Collaborative, that students at Roosevelt High School who are prepared to go to college and college-ready don't want to apply. They're afraid, and they're afraid because they're saying, you know, there are no slots. They're aware. They're aware that there are no slots in higher education. They're aware that the fees have gone up and that they're going to go up more. And they're afraid that even if they apply, they're not going to be able to get in because there's going to be no room for them. So here we have this spiral where you have teachers that, or people that want to go into education that can't, are not going to go because they're saying, why am I going to go if I'm going to get fired in a year or two? And now you have students who are saying, I don't want to go to, I'm afraid to go to college because there's no room for me because it's going to cost more. And so these are students.
Is that a coincidence or is that a way of lessening the demand for higher ed?
I think that that's a way of lessening the demand for higher education.
Suzanne, you have a question on that.
Well, because, you know, I'm thinking of community colleges sort of across the country where they're not at the same tipping point that California is, but they are seeing a massive increase in terms of students coming in because they can't afford the four-year institution. So that's why that was my quizzical look. I was sort of trying to think, I don't know that it's on purpose, but I will say that, you know, everybody's seeing these increases and they're not able to take on all of the students that they have. Everybody in higher education are increasing their fees and tuition. And I think the challenge for higher ed is for so long higher ed pretended none of these cuts were going to happen. And so now they're in a crisis situation. And so you're seeing just insane ways of cutting things that are just not thoughtful. And I guess I'm hearing a lot of parallels in terms of what's happening in the K-12 world. And I would love it if we could kind of get both worlds together to think about how do you make smart choices in very, very tough economic times. The economy's not going to change soon. But how can we just make smart choices in tough economic times? And I don't know, have the answer to that, but it might be an interesting kind of dialogue.
Who's got the microphone?
Oh, there are a lot of hands.
There we go.
Hi, Mark Fort, Mount St. Mary's College. We are officially an Hispanic-serving institution, so we rely heavily on our quantitative data. However, the question continues to beg in my mind, for a community that's based so much in relationship, how might we change the paradigm to include the student narrative to inform us about structures for the future?
Thank you. To
the educator.
Thank you. I'm involved in two education collaboratives on behalf of East Los Angeles College. One of them is the Boyle Heights Education Collaborative. The other one is the East Los Angeles Education Collaborative. And we did exactly that. Okay, so when they opened new schools that hadn't been opened in the community in 40 years, they've actually opened some new schools in both the East Side areas. And we actually asked, you know, we said, let's get a cohort of students and see what they think we need to do as colleges and as nonprofit organizations that are supporting these schools to see what the students need. And of course, on our end, you know, we think, well, more tutoring, mentoring, financial aid, opportunities for the students to interact, you know, outside of the classroom and so on.
And you ask them, and you know what they came up with? A co-op, a food co-op for the community. They came up with clothing exchange, you know? They came up with toy exchange, because all of them have younger brothers and sisters who don't have toys or who have very limited access to toys. So they figured if we all bring toys that, and then we exchange them, then our brothers and sisters get to have new toys without having to buy toys. It was just amazing, you know, and absolutely the student voice is needed in focus groups so that we can know, you know, what needs to be done.
Can I add to that?
Sure.
Okay, just a couple of quick things. There's an organization called mobilize.org. We support them, and they do student organizing, so it sounds like you know them. Also, the Business Innovation Factory, which is based in Providence, Rhode Island, did a series of videos to capture students talking about their student experience at both four-year and two-year institutions. And then MTV has their Get Schooled project, which I think is also a great way to engage students. And the final thing that I'll just say about the importance of student voices is, so another student I met recently, Miguel, just came back from two tours of duty in Iraq, and he tested into developmental math. And what did he say? He said, I am terrified of developmental math. Wasn't scared of two tours of duty in Iraq, but he was terrified of developmental math. And I say that because capturing him saying that, like just hearing him say that, gives you an entirely different perspective mm-hmm. on the kinds of programs, on the kinds of interventions that you want to use with students. Because, you know, you'd never get that. You wouldn't get that out of data. You sort of need data plus that.
Right.
I think we have time for... Well, whoever has the microphone. There's somebody very eager in the back, and there's a gentleman here.
Good afternoon. My name is Sergio Rosas. I'm with Families in Schools. My question is, you know, we use accountability a lot. It's a buzzword, and it's a word that we've used a lot recently in the last couple of years in education. So I just want to take a moment to ask the panelists, how do you define accountability? How do we make accountability an action as opposed to a buzzword, and what actions can we take as community-based organizations to ensure accountability for quality public schools?
That's a really good question. Actually, because our judgment system on schools is so narrow, we don't really have accountability system in that meaning. Mm-hmm. What we have is a testing embarrassment system.
Right.
So we sort of embarrass people. There's no... Like, nobody goes to the board members in LA Unified or Central, any school district and say, look, we've just done assessments, and guess what? You can't run for office anymore because you've managed this district. Or, I'm sorry, the superintendent and the top staff, they lose their credential. See, that's making adults accountable, not just embarrassing a school. The highest level we got to is when we identify schools. And by the way, we've identified schools with 800 APIs as failing schools in California mm-hmm. to give them some federal money.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But when we identify them, then we say, but there's only four ways to improve you.
Right. Mm-hmm.
When we know exactly what they are, because we sat in some room in bureaucracy in Washington, D.C. and described them for you. So that's not accountability. That's just some more nonsense.
Nonsense?
Well, I was in that room. when that conversation happened.
He has a way with making friends.
So no, I mean, I think a big piece of the accountability, again, is how is it that the community is going to be involved on deciding mm-hmm. how things are going to happen at that school, right? Mm-hmm. And again, from my perspective, right, I come from a system in Chicago where principals were hired and fired by parents. Right, and budgets were approved and had to be amended by parents.
Changed the system.
Excuse me?
But then you changed the system.
No, the system's been like that for the last 15 years. So
talking about the school councils.
Yeah.
How's that working?
So again, so it depends on the level of accountability that people have in training parents to be able to make those decisions, right? Because you cannot just put parents there and say, you could make those decisions in schools. The question is how of a robust developmental and training program you have. And actually, Nadal used to do the trainings and stopped doing them for a while.
The money dried up.
Right, exactly. So when Nadal was running them, it was great.
I just think it's rather interesting, though, that the comment that John just made, we have schools on their API have scored 800, yeah, right? But under No Child Left Behind, they're still failing schools. How can that be? So that every school eventually in the state of California, in fact, the entire country, will become a failing school. How is that accountable? Mm-hmm. How did that happen, that you are labeling a school as a failing school because they haven't reached a benchmark, but they've reached, according to the state standards, they've reached their mark?
William Gilbert, CHCI. I've got a question. I know we've talked a lot about K through 12 issues and accountability and even access. And so my question goes back to the higher education system once they're in. So they've traveled this hard road. They've fought all these obstacles. They finally get in, and they started to see the end of the, you know, oh, I'm going to do this. But yet stats say that there's a 50%, you know, after a first year, a third of those college freshmen will not come back. And the entire system has a 50% attrition rate. Mm-hmm. And so what more can be done? Because all the emphasis is on the student. Should be more done to the institution in an accountability to try to maintain those students in school once they get into school?
I mean, this is really, I think, so much of what we talk about when we talk about redesign is how do we keep the student in and progressing through the system. The other thing is you can look at things like Washington State where they've changed their funding model, like Tina was talking about, and their funding model is really geared at looking at various momentum points along the way. So the better you are at getting students through those developmental ed classes, and especially if they're low-income students, then through the system, you get points or you get money along the way. So you're actually rewarded for keeping them and progressing them through a system. I think that that's part of it, but a lot of it really has to do with restructuring. I mean, we've always had a focus on, I think we did a great job of focusing on access for many, many years. And I think we didn't really realize that access was a slightly hollow promise. I mean, you really actually have to get the students through. And completion, again, for us could mean a credential or a degree. But there are lots of ways of thinking about that, but we're still experimenting. I think there are some promising practices, but I think we're still experimenting with what keeps students engaged.
We once did a computer model, that said, what if we cut the high school dropout rate in half and the college increase the college completion rate by 50%? The computer tells us that would cost you $11 billion more a year, mm-hmm, because you have too many kids. Mm-hmm. Systems built on not having enough people complete, because if they did, we'd have to fund them.
Marilena?
One of the things that can be done institutionally, actually several things, is the institutions have to take a much more aggressive posture, and I do mean that, to retain students. You have to have in-depth, meaningful counseling for your students as they come in. You have to have a robust orientation, and that orientation includes parent engagement right away so that parents know why their students are going there in the first place, what does that university or college or community college has to offer. The orientation will include programming the students so that they have their classes, and then, of course, providing the academic support that they need and making academic support centers available. And publish these, and definitely financial aid. At ELAC, there are two major movements that we have. In the fall is the movement widely publicized for students who want to transfer. So I'm the director of the Learning Assistance Center. So the counselors and the financial aid people will come into the Learning Center twice or three or four times a year and bring in students in the fall so that they can apply to college online, and in the spring so they can apply for financial aid and complete their FAFSA. And so you have to have a very aggressive stand as an institution. In higher ed institutions traditionally have been passive. We're here, let's see what the students want to do. We can't do that anymore.
Okay, we have to unfortunately end this conversation. Suzanne looks like she needs to get off stage.
They are signaling me about
okay, all right. So final question to each of you, and a one-word answer. Okay? The title of this session was Keeping the Promise, Creating Access and Accountability. Who are we not holding accountable in this whole conversation that we've been having about access and persistence in higher education? Who or what? One word.
I want to say the...
That's more than one word.
The state lawmakers.
Higher ed?
Accreditors.
Mm-hmm. Wealthy.
The wealthy.
Legislature.
Legislature. Yeah.
Accreditors.
Please help me thank our panel.
I'm just going to wrap it up. One, let's thank the panel once again. Also, our outstanding moderators, Arturo, and we had also... and, of course, we had Deborah at the first one. Thank you, Deborah and Arturo. As we open this up, we talked about this as being a critically urgent conversation on two timely issues. One, the dynamic and growing Latino population, and that the trying to change this conversation because we're trying to really bring home the urgency. And one way to do that is to talk about the Latino community as having already emerged as 25% of the nation in the near future. And a key statistic that NCLR has is they say that 9 out of 10 of elementary school students are native born. So when they talk about, you know the immigrant equation, this is our future. 9 out of 10 elementary kids, Latino kids, are native born. 80% of new jobs will require some degree. So the other key element here is where Latinos stand in this national effort to increase degree attainment to 60% by 2030. We know the nation moved from first in the world in college degrees to 12th. And that wasn't necessarily a reduction in people graduating. Other countries just had more increases. The same number of people are graduating from college a generation ago than are today. So rather than seeing increases, our systems have all stayed the same, assuming that's the same level that needs to graduate. So we know, and we talked about, that the competitive strength of the U.S. is tied to the success of the Latino community. We're talking about the economic success as well, the tax base. Who's going to keep the Social Security solvent? So also, Hispanic Scholarship Fund has put together some good data that puts, what the tax base looks like if you increase college graduation. And, of course, what we heard today, some goal setting, and attention to completion, some specific ideas to address the gaps that don't necessarily require more money. It's challenging the current paradigms. I like some of the ideas that I heard. For example, how do we just integrate some of the college readiness into the high school curriculum, or just some things that can be done, again, without it costing a lot of money. So what does accountability look like? What data is needed, and how should that data be used? Of course, we need Latino employment at all levels of our education system, from more Latino teachers up to Latino superintendents. The question of leadership. As an organization that works on leadership, it's seeing people, some risk takers, to challenge, again, the current curriculum paradigms or, the governments that need to pay attention to the state's future or the nation's future. What we're going to keep this dialogue going. We had diverse sectors represented today, diverse views and voices. What we talked about was, one, you're going to walk out of here not with all of your questions answered. You probably have more, it raises more questions, but What we're going to do is William and mainly Miguel, who I introduced at the beginning. Miguel is our graduate education fellow. He has all your emails. He's going to send you information that was shared here. We also want to collect best practices and share them with you. If you have a best practice at a community level that you feel, you know, you want to share with the group, send it to us. We will keep that going. And the last piece is that we will keep you updated on just efforts between us and Excelencia in Education and others, efforts on what we're doing to track and measure the Latino attainment portion as this national debate continues. So that's our commitment to you. And thank you again for being here. We again, thanks to Fox Deportes for hosting our reception. And we invite you to join the continuing dialogue. Muchísimas gracias.